welcome to Insight. I'm Suhaila Kapoor. The Indo-Pak NSA talks have stalled. Both sides are adhering to their positions amidst high-decibel rhetoric. India wants only terrorism on the agenda, and Pakistan wants the Kashmiri separatists involved in the process. What is at stake now that the talks between the two nuclear-powered neighbors have been called off? Can one hope for a peaceful overture from Pakistan in the near future? We discuss this today on Insight. Joining me in this discussion today is Mr. Sreeram Chaulia, Dean, Jindal School of International Affairs. Mr. Chaulia, the other dossier was that on Dawood, and there is evidence that his family is residing in Karachi, as well as the pending trial in the 2611 Mumbai attack case. So, your view on that?
There was a time when we thought that he was in the Gulf.
Yes.
And not in Pakistan. They had been shifting him,
right,
to try and deflect attention to the fact that he is basically made Karachi's base. And I think it becomes more important in the light of this Yaqub Memon case and so on, because they may be plotting more attacks as a kind of revenge for his execution. So in a way, he's come back to the limelight, and it's necessary to highlight him. Because one way of looking at it is he's old, fish, and this is 20 years ago, and there are more new actors like Lakhvi and so on. But Dawood Ibrahim remains at large and capable of, because of his criminal syndicates in India, capable of relaunching major attacks. So I think it was important that we laid out, dusted off his file, because we haven't been hearing about him for some time now. As far as other 2611 attackers and plotters go, yes, the complicity of the military is important for us to show, and to show that there are commanding officers of the Pakistani army who are directly involved in that attack, and we have been doing that anyway. So I tend to think that Sushma Swaraj was right in saying that they were running away scared from this dialogue, because the mountain of evidence we had was so overwhelming. And that list that Sardar is waving to the media, frankly, is, it's not credible. And at best, they may, show that we have financed some Baloch insurgents or something like that. That, at best, that's somewhat credible, because these are not jihadists. But the claims that, we are financing the Tehrik-e-Taliban Pakistan and other Punjabi Taliban and all this is just, hocus pocus. So, at the end of the day, what can they achieve? It's a kind of, their attempt has always been to create a false kind of moral equivalence between us and them. So, if you have a list, we have a list. If you say one attack, we give you the opposite. So, it's a kind of, recrimination.
It's like if somebody from the Indian government went there and said, okay, we're going to have these talks, but let's talk to the Baloch militants first, the Baloch fighters. Would Pakistan accept that?
Well, we should see. When Sushma Swaraj tells the Chinese, if you want a one China policy, you should acknowledge a one India policy. We should also be doing the same.
In a way,
it may be confirming what they have already claimed to have been happening behind the scenes. But whatever it is, at the end of the day, either through covert means or through public meetings, we should send across the message that if talks are not working, then we have other options to be able to raise the costs and to deter this kind of terrorism. And remember, it's not only about Kashmir. They said they're talking about Kashmir. What does Gurdaspur have to do with Kashmir? It happened in Punjab along the international border, although they snuck in from the J&K side. So at the end of the day, the jihad that they're waging is at an all-India level. And it's not just limited to Kashmir. And I don't think, it's a bit like people saying that the Arab-Israeli problems will be solved the moment you resolve Palestine. No, but it's a deeper tendency. It goes back to the foundational ideology of the Pakistan army, that scholars like Christine Fair have shown, that it is the, it is defined as one which is against India. So as a result of that, I think Kashmir is being brought in simply because Nawaz Sharif was under pressure after Ufa. Why was the K word not in the...
There was criticism in Pakistan itself, apparently.
Exactly.
And the government did not intend to include the separatists, but they were forced to.
They were forced
because
to
of the criticism.
Because
and from probably army pressure.
Because it seemed like, for the hardliners,
yes,
in the establishment and the jihadists, who are quite powerful socially also in,
yes,
Pakistan, Nawaz Sharif is selling out. And therefore he needs to be reined in. And that's what has happened.
Mr. Chaulia, do you think this incident has made Hurriyat larger than life?
Well,
whereas it would have been a very avoidable prospect.
No, I think, see, I've been to Mali recently, and always I feel that Hurriyat conference, you know, some people call them the Hartal conference. They're more, you know, in demonstration of street power.
Right.
And that too in some limited urban areas.
Right.
They've never been tested electorally. So what you have them is a kind of like, you know, a grouping of so-called elders who are like rabble-rousers. Mm-hmm. And there are a lot of youth who are unemployed, and Modi government should be working hard on this, especially since the militancy has now declined, but there's still a lot of unemployed youth. A lot of them are being actually paid to come out and hurl stones at the police and to shut down things. And Hurriyat is behind most of this. So, interestingly, whether the Hurriyat is allowed to meet the Pakistani diplomats and visitors or not, they do have a channel for financing. And it's an open secret. Everybody knows that Gilani and his faction especially receive direct money from the Pakistani state and the intelligence. So that connection, I think we want to snap it once and for all. Mm. So one measure for Modi government, which is forthright, is no public meetings between Hurriyat and Pakistani government officials.
Mm.
Two, more importantly, all these channels they have to be cut, you know. It's a way of, you know, like we say, how do you counter terrorism? You have to counter terrorism financing. Right, and what Hurriyat is getting is, because Hurriyat is at the softer end of the terrorist spectrum. So on one hand, basically they sympathize with the jihadists, but they have not openly called for, you know, violent attacks of late.
Mm.
So what they do instead is they mobilize the youth and say we will do civil disobedience on the streets and all that kind of thing.
Gandhian tactics.
Some of them have blood on their hands. People like Yasin Malik have killed civilians.
Yes, they have.
So then at the other end of the spectrum is the hardline jihadists, with whom, so that essentially the hand that feeds Hurriyat as well as the jihadists is the same.
Mm.
Right, so you cannot really make a distinction between the two, and I think that's good. Government of India is saying they are not legitimate. And frankly, I think the other point we want to make in all this is, we have an elected coalition government in Jammu and Kashmir.
Yes.
That we had a huge mass turnout in the elections, 70% or so. So they are legitimate, and Hurriyat is not. They have never participated in formal channels. So at the end of the day, what we are trying to also show is that our normalization process in the valley will continue. And by isolating Hurriyat, we are going to, you know, strengthen our hand in Jammu and Kashmir.
Right. First of all, Minister of External Affairs Sushma Swaraj has said that there have been 91 ceasefire violations since Ufa already. But the Foreign Secretary S. Jaishankar said that we made four attempts by the DG of the Border Security Force to make telephonic conversation with the sector commander of Sialkot. No response. So how dangerous does this make the situation that we're not talking to each other between two nuclear powered nations?
Even during the Zardari's period, the People's Party, when it had completed its term, it was a big news that for the first time a civilian government has been allowed to complete a 5-year term. And now I think they will allow Nawaz Sharif to also complete his term. So what looks like has happened is a kind of a pact where they have drawn the lines as to where how far the civilian leaders can go, and in return they will not carry out any more military coups. So what is happening is it's a kind of like an informal military rule. It's not a formal military rule, and with a civilian facade. Mm. And perhaps more than Zardari, Nawaz Sharif has a mass constituency and is more a popular politician. So we can argue that maybe the balance is slightly better in the last 3 years compared to the People's Party time. But essentially the bargain is the same, as I see it, which is that on the what they call the, you know, the core interests, be it Afghanistan or Kashmir, India policy in general, or just the defense budget, security issues in general, the military will call the shots and you have to follow the lead. Maybe they will cede some economic decisions, but even there the military controls a lot of the industries and the... So now the question is, how can you reverse this and change the tide? And unless there is a structural transformation there, we will not have a real partner in peace. But and how can we assist? So while you made an interesting distinction between the society and the state, and especially the security establishment within the state, I think our only option is to continue to, and I think Prime Minister Modi is right in seeking dialogue. He made a very important point that if you give up the path of terror, dialogue is the only way, and we are always interested in dialogue.
Yes.
So I think he will want to drive this wedge further, whether it is successful or not, we don't know, to try and change the structural balance in that country. The other way of saying is that, you know, it's doomed to be that way and we'll have to wait for a revolution there. Now, what is a revolution? We saw Tahir al-Qadri, another military proxy, who was brought forward to say we are going to bring about social revolution in Pakistan. What he eventually did was again weaken the civilian president, Prime Minister Nawaz Sharif. So now the debt is stacked, and I think we are looking at, you know, 2 years down the line, they've got a bailout from the IMF and they'll probably get some money from the Chinese to fix their electricity and power and infrastructure problems, just to, so that Nawaz Sharif may get re-elected. And I think the army is now comfortable with both People's Party and with Pakistan Muslim League, because no matter whoever is coming, through bad experiences of military coups and assassinations of Benazir and so on, they've realized that there is a limit and they'll not transgress the limit. And now I think the army is, so it's a good cop, bad cop kind of routine. So Nawaz Sharif comes forward and, you know, wants trade and business and people-to-people relations, economic interdependence, all the good things that Prime Minister Modi professes, but then he's pulled back from now and then and shown his place. Public relations shaming. Because also sometimes helps.
Yes.
Maybe not all classified data, but at least some of the names and the prominent ones can be shared.
Yeah.
And they have been shared with individual governments, but not out in the media in great detail.
So it's been an on and off kind of a situation. We talk peace, but something takes place. We talk peace, yes.
But Sohila, nonetheless,
yes,
you know, it all adds up. I mean, it's a cumulative process.
Mm.
I mean, you cannot say that it's totally futile to keep, you know, presenting more and more evidence and having these dialogues, because what happens is, see, even 1971, the run-up to the breakup of Pakistan, Mrs. Gandhi actually engaged in a lot of international diplomacy and piled up the evidence to show who is the wrongdoer, and then it became a conducive environment for us to create Bangladesh in 1971. So, you know, it all adds up. So you may have a coup de grace kind of situation, as Pakistan could, you know, it's churning in its own juices in many ways. There's so many insurgencies going on within that country. And if it ever comes to a point where we have to further weaken them, all these things will matter, you know. So, the, in a way, it's like we're putting it on the record and we must rightly do so.
What do you think is should be the solution? Because Sardar Aziz has suggested that the way out may be that the Kashmir government includes the separatists in the process. And Sheri Rehman, the former ambassador, has said the two sides will have to stop being Cold War dinosaurs. But some others say perhaps, you know, we should take some time before we start negotiating again to let things cool down a little bit and the tensions are sorted out. So very quickly, your opinion on this.
I want to add that, you know, the Prime Minister has made a very important point about SALT minus one.
Mm.
And we should intensify that project. Regional integration without the spoiler. And we are advancing the BBIN, Bangladesh, Bhutan, India, Nepal economic corridor.
Yeah.
And there are going to be many more such opportunities. So essentially, we have actually a pretty docile and harmonious neighborhood except for the Western neighbor. So I think we've got to stress that. Eventually, hopefully, some, you know, rational sense will come in that on the Pakistani side that they're missing out on all these regional integration initiatives of ours. So the more we isolate them economically through regional integration with the rest of the SALT members, I think they're going to stand out like a sore thumb. And anyway, their image has been spoiled by the fact that it is seen as a factory for jihadists and it is seen as a global alert. If you're on a Pakistani passport, travel anywhere in the world, they're going to hold you up and interrogate you because of fear that you're bringing in something, you know, violent.
Or so, even if you belong to India or any other country and you've gone to Pakistan,
it becomes a checkpoint. So
yes,
we have to isolate them, and the SALT minus one process is the way forward. We need to do a lot more with our smaller neighbors. And I think bring them along. Afghanistan, unfortunately, is cut off from us territorially because Pakistan is in between. But we can deal with them through the sea and with Iran. And all these are eventually going to make a difference, hopefully, in changing their behavior.
Right. No other solution except negotiation. Well, that's all in this episode of